Hello there, buckaroos. Here I am, John Doe, right here in Tokyo, Japan. Now, we have a very special guest here today. Here on the Ghost Hunters Report, right? Here with me is Comrade Jackson. Now, he's a very good friend of the channel, he's a very good friend of mine, and he should be a good friend of yours. And what we're doing today is something kind of unique and special, which you probably have never seen on this channel. Something I never tried to do, but I've kind of always wanted to do. What I wanted to do is talk about the realities of teaching English in Japan. Now, there's a lot of, like, you know, Gaijin YouTubers out there who talk about teaching English in Japan. And they say what they want to say. That's fine. Here on this channel, we're going to do things a bit different. We're going to talk about it from a worker's perspective. Not from some bougie idea of just whatever a teacher should be and how to survive in Japan. We're going to talk about the nuts and bolts of it. That's right. Enjoy that Budweiser. Right? We're going to talk about the nuts and bolts of it. The actual realities that teachers face. And the topic here, the particulars of it, we're going to talk about freelancing in Japan.
Yeah, right.
And this, our comrade Jackson here knows a lot about it. He's extensive experience in it, and he's quite, unfortunately, successful at it. Right? So it's going on with it, right? Mm-hmm. So I think you'll find us to be very intriguing, especially if you are English teachers like we are here in Japan, or just want to know more about this. Because a lot of, like, subterfuge and a lot of misinformation about what it is to be an English teacher in Japan, what it goes through. And freelancing is one of those areas which a lot of people don't know about. So the first thing we want to talk about is the go-to option, what people think is freelancing in Japan, which is the student-teacher option. Now, these are typically done through websites where you sign up, you make this pretty little profile, you upload your picture, and potential clients contact you for lessons. Now, Comrade Jackson, can you tell us more about this and how this is maybe not the best option to go to, or maybe is a good option to go to, where someone wanted to freelance English teaching full-time in Japan? You have the floor.
Yeah, no problem, man. Like, the first thing you gotta learn is you're always gonna be making somebody else money if you're in this type of thing. Like, when you go to a website, a teacher-student introduction thing, usually students are paying the webmaster for a service to introduce them to any teacher and to put them in their location and things like that. Money that the teacher will never see. But the good side of it, the pros of it, is that, you know, if you're already working a job and you got some free time to yourself and you need to fill in that gap, then you can go to these websites and you can get students at any location that you want to go to and charge them whatever you want.
I think that's a very good perspective right there.
Yeah.
And you need to know that, like, going to these websites expecting to do this full-time freelancing.
Oh, hell no. No.
Exactly.
Yeah, fuck that. No, there's no way that you're going to make a living off of these websites unless you go at it with a freelance mindset. Like, you got to break the mold of it, because usually what teachers go for is they want to get, you know, 3,500 yen per hour or 90
minutes. Right about that. That's the standard going rate these days.
It is. You got to somehow exceed that, and the way that I've exceeded it, I mean, me and myself, I could go exclusively the teacher-student websites and do that, but what you have to do, you have to exceed the expectations. You're never going to get to the top if you only limit yourself to getting 3,500 yen per hour per student, because you're too much exclusive. You know, that's 1 hour per one person, you know? You're not putting that into a group lesson, getting group money for it. You're not giving discounts to anybody, and you're not getting group rates for anybody. If you do things like that, you will be successful with that. But 90% of the population, when they go to do something like that, they will fail and fall on their face.
this guy is always speaking the truth. I know it for myself. I've done these student teaching introduction things in my past. And like I said, like he said, you can get... Well, I was... At one time, I had like 10 students on the side. Mm-hmm. While I was working a regular full-time gig at a company, right? Mm-hmm. And I tell you, that's a lot of goddamn work.
Yeah.
Here you are trying to like work this full-time job. Mm-hmm. At the same time, when you get off work, mm-hmm. you're also rushing, like rushing your ass off to make it to this train station, wherever the hell the student wants you to meet. Mm-hmm. And trying to put together a lesson on the fly. Mm-hmm. Now, an experienced teacher knows how to do a lesson on the fly.
Yeah.
Because often you've had a couple email exchanges with your private student.
Yeah.
And you know what they're looking for. Mm-hmm. And if you've been teaching for at least 2 years, mm-hmm. me and him, we both have over 10 years experience, by the way. But even someone who's had like at least 2 years experience, on the train ride from your company, where you're stationed at, to the private student, you can get a lesson up your head.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. If you really get this, you can do this. It's not that hard.
Yeah.
You know, if you know your grammar, and you know what the student wants, and you have a solid base, and you're as an English teacher, you can do this. Mm-hmm. But this is not preferred. If your intention is to go freelance and do this full time.
Yeah.
So, it's a good segue into our next point. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about Yochins.
Yochins. That's Japanese for kindergarten.
Kindergarten. We're going to talk about kindergarten, right?
The first thing you got to go with that is you got to learn to love.
I think Kamar Jackson gave us a good perspective on this because it really is some dirty business going on here.
Yeah.
It really is a really, really dirty business mm-hmm. that a lot of teachers don't know about. You know, mm-hmm. I was a bit aware of this mm-hmm. because of my union activity. But until I met Comrade Jackson and the things he told me privately about what really goes on in teaching kindergartens, mm-hmm. you know, it really informed me just how much the English teachers are getting ripped the fuck off in Japan. And how you're treated when you're teaching kindergartens.
Yeah.
So to kind of guide this, what I hope be an informative conversation about this, we're going to let Comrade Jackson talk about the middleman problem in Japan.
Yeah.
And how like a lot of these schools you'll go to don't want to deal with these AOT middleman guys. Uh-huh. AOT in Japan, it means basically you're working. What often happens is that you are you're hired by a company. You get a job at a company, right? And they like dispatch you to work in a kindergarten, which means you don't work for the actual kindergarten. You're given a wage based on the profit given to the company. Now, Comrade Jackson has a very interesting perspective on this. We're going to give him the floor to talk about how this dirty business goes down and how he has found a way to cut out this shit, which is no way a anti-capitalist perspective, but is a way to beat capitalists at their own game. Now, Comrade Jackson, you have the floor. You have the ability to talk fully about this, and everyone is very interested in hearing what you have to say about this. So, please, you have the floor, sir.
Oh, man, I'm interested to tell about it. Like, let me tell you, I'm actually a hardcore rap, hip-hop artist, and I never thought that teaching English would, like, ever amount enough, and I figured it'd just be a way to make some quick money while I'm trying to pursue my dreams. Well, I ended up getting a passion for it. And when you get a passion for something, it's really, really hardcore to get let down by greed of capitalists, you know? So when I got my first company, I was working 6 days a week and getting anywhere between, like, $1,800 a month to $2,500 a month, the standard, you know, fee that you get for your salary. And what I found out one day is these 6 days, six different locations, six different kindergartens or yochins, that I was teaching at, one time they forgot to do a bank transfer, and they gave me this little bag of money, and they trusted me to take this to my company. And so, what are you going to do in the train if you got this big bag of money and you work at this location 2 days a week? What are you going to do? You're going to open that shit. Like, how much money am I worth? You know? When I open that motherfucker, it said, can I cuss?
Oh, you my want to? Oh, you want me? No one's going to, like, tell you not to.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, because when
you, as you want, speak as you feel.
No problem. When I opened that motherfucker, and it had $2,500 in it. That's 250,000 yen in it. That's how much this location is paying a middleman to send your ass there for only 2 days a week. Now, keep in mind, you're working 6 days a week, and what's your salary? 250,000 yen. So you gotta like multiply that by three. How much money are you making these motherfuckers, and how much money are they paying your ass? It ain't shit, it's basically pennies, and you can guarantee that these Japanese companies don't really speak English. But they're making money off of your ass. So that's a key factor there. Now, when I went to my next company, it was more like 5 days a week. No, 6 days a week. But instead of the 2,500 thing, you could get like 3,500 a month. And only start from the afternoons in there, because the first job I had, you had a Japanese lady, usually a cute girl, this bilingual, and they could like translate for you anywhere you go, like an ALT, assistant language teacher, you know. But with this $3,500 deal, you teach English with no help. You got to control the classroom, everything, for your 50 minutes to an hour, however you're going to do it. But see, this was the catch. If you're late 1 second, 1 minute, any fucking thing like that, it is 5,000 yen or 50 American dollars out of your paycheck. If you're absent for any reason, 1 day is $100, 10,000 yen out of your check, no questions asked.
Damn.
When my father passed away, age 49, you know, and I had to take off and go back to America, every day was 10,000 yen out of my
damn check.
I ended up owing these motherfuckers money.
How can you owe someone
when your parents
continue? Yeah. Come on, Jackson, you know, please. This is really
that's the thing you learn, and that's the shit that you get. When people ask me, like, how do I do what I do and how can they do what I do, I tell them, I say, get you about one or two ain't shit company jobs in Japan. That way you can learn what's good and what's bad, what works for you, and where your passion is. Because if I automatically give you something like this, you're not gonna respect it. You know, when I tell folks that. And a lot of folks fall short of the glory. And a lot of folks listen to what I say and build up their own stuff. And that's really a beautiful thing. I'm all for that. And see, this is where it comes down. You know, when I come back after burying my dad, you know, I found out that I had a divorce and lost my kids and things like that. And I was basically homeless in Tokyo with this fucking company. And they started thinking they could treat me like a bitch. But I put that on pause. And I started making my own curriculums. I started going to different places and presenting my ideas. I got a lot of no's. And then all it takes is that one magical yes. When you make your stuff and you say, I don't need a company. You just make a contract with me directly. You know? You go in there, you show them the materials, and don't ever ask for money. Just say, I want to give you a free taiken, which is a demonstration lesson. You go in there, you do it, you rock the house, and then, hell, they'll pick you. You go in there, and remember, what are they used to paying for 2 days a week? $250. No. What? $2,500. They're a little bit drunk. 250,000 yen. That's what they end up paying. But shit, you go in there, you cut the throat. You say, I'll do it for $800. 80,000 yen, I'll do it for that. And then you work your deal up from there.
I gotta tell you, that's very, very intriguing. There's a lot of good information there. A lot of you guys don't know about. Because teaching English in Japan, you know, when you're in a Western country, a native English speaking country, they present this image of you.
Mm-hmm.
Of, come on, teach English and be a part of Japan.
Yeah.
But when you get here, as Comrade Jackson has pointed out, it's not exactly as advertised to you.
No.
You're actually getting ripped the fuck off in this country. Mm. Hardcore.
You know what happened to the guys at Shane?
Oh, tell us about the... Because I have some union comrades at Shane.
Yeah.
Maybe you can ask perspective because, you know, you live it.
Yeah.
You know, come tell us about it at Shane, because Shane is a very interesting case.
Yo, that's some fucked up shit. Like, because that's the way English companies will do, like, foreigners that come over. Like, they want you to work. They want you to do overtime. They want to pay you pennies and get you for the least amount of price possible for the most peak hours that you can teach.
Oh yeah.
And these two fellas came over with Shane's, and now you gotta think about what Shane's is. Shane's is not Shane's. What Shane, the Shane guy, would actually do is buy these locations of schools, and then he would sell them to people to have their own
school. They do franchise, right?
Franchise, right?
Yeah, they franchise it
and
out.
So
yeah.
Like it was like Shane ain't had nothing to do with this. It was like something that Shane sold to somebody, a location. And this location decided to hire teachers and then hired these two guys in and shit. I think it was two different locations, maybe. Mm. And then they found out, oh, I'm going to have a baby. You know, one guy got his wife pregnant and then had to go to the hospital for the delivery, right?
It just sounds like something bad is about to happen here. Because anytime in Japan, I'm a family man myself, as long as Comrade Jackson. Yeah. Whenever you talk about family and have concerns for your child, tell us about it, man. Tell us how this goes down.
So these dudes, they didn't get paid for any of the, you know, the time they took off to go see their child being born, you know. And, I mean, me and myself, I've been, you know, kind of raised tailored in the hardcore aspect of, you don't work, you don't get paid, you know. Closed mouths don't get fed.
Well, you know, it's mm-hmm. unfortunately, that's rather true.
Yeah, but see, and the rest of the world and the country we come from, America, you know, we get that type of leave, you know. And these two guys, they fought their ass off in the litigation system, got lawyers in court and all that shit. And I think they won, didn't they? Or they're still fighting it now, right?
Currently, Shane labor union is still fighting this.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to what we call strategic strikes.
Yeah.
Strategic strikes in a labor union here in Japan is basically where you strike when at short notice. It's not a wildcat. It's not a wildcat strike.
Yeah.
That's different. Wildcat strike means you go against the union and you strike at will.
Yeah.
That's a rebellion. That's a workers' rebellion against the labor union.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, not different. Strategic strike. Excuse my pronunciation.
Mm-hmm.
We've both been drinking. Is where you strike when you think you have the highest potential to financially damage a company.
Yeah.
And that's what they've been doing for about 3 years now.
Mm.
And they've been fighting this hard.
Yeah.
And what they've been fighting for, basically, is guaranteed money.
Yeah.
Right? Which means, like, we work a lesson, you can give us this money. Mm. And you're going to work us at these schools.
Mm-hmm.
Not try to drag us around all the time like a lot of companies do.
Yeah.
It's typical in Akiwa.
It is. It totally is.
So, hey man, we're up to our Shane brothers out there.
Mm.
We're fully support you, we're behind you, and we know what you're going through, and nothing but a fight for you. Fight these capitalists, Fox.
I tried to find a picture or something so I could show it to you, but I don't got it here.
Don't worry about that. These if people will see this video, they want to look up, they will.
Yeah.
So the third point we want to look into is a very interesting point that a lot of people don't really know about, and they're not really aware of it, as an avenue for the freelance.
Yeah.
Is culture centers.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. This is something that was new to me up until a couple of years ago, and Comrade Jackson here has a lot of very intriguing information about this, how this works, if you're going to freelance to culture centers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my understanding, culture centers in Japan are very crucial to local society, how local communities are set up.
Mm-hmm.
Culture centers offer many different things to Japanese people. And not only Japanese people, but people in general. I've taken advantage of some of these services, right? give a good example of how culture standards have benefited me. When we were having our child, me and my loving wife, we took advantage of one of the free government funded programs.
I got one of my mustache hairs caught in the can. And it ripped it out. You can see it right there, dude. Like, you see it in there?
Oh, god damn, I swear to God.
I tried to look cool about it, but I was just like, and I had to rip it out.
This is realness here on the Ghost Terrors Report. This is being real.
Like, somebody gonna see it and be like, oh, he yanked his mustache hair out.
Oh, so fuck, it happens, right? This is realness, right?
Yeah.
Anyways, right? We were trying to be professional human beings, but goddamn.
You can edit that out.
Comrade Jackson had to get his fucking mustache caught on his fucking beer can. Of all that damn hillbilly redneck thing, I swear to God.
You saw me. You was over there talking. You was doing great, man. I was just like,
you had to fuck it up, didn't you? Anyway, let's try to refocus, man. What were you talking about? We were talking about
your lovely wife and how she did a lot for you.
You know,
and
I don't want to use profanity, but anyway, we're talking about culture centers.
Yeah, the culture centers, yeah.
How important culture centers are?
Yeah, there's two types.
There's two types, right? And the one I went to is probably a different one he dealt with. The one I dealt with is here in my local neighborhood.
That's a good one.
Yeah, they take care of you here, don't they? Right? It's rare, but it's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Where they offered me a pre-parent seminar. It's a archetypical thing you expect, right?
Mm-hmm.
You go there, and you wear this like baby strap, so the father knows what it's like to be pregnant. It's that rigmarole, right? And they give you a seminar on how to bathe a newborn infant.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very impressed by this, and very amazed that the government here in Japan, for all it is and how fucked up it is,
mm-hmm.
would fund these things.
Yeah.
And I looked on the list; they had a list of different programs you could sign up for.
Mm.
It was this long ass list of things that were government funded,
mm-hmm.
and most of them were so helpful for people, communities, how they deal with things, right?
Yeah.
But we ain't talking about that. Mm. Right? We're going to talk about the English language part of it, right?
Yeah.
Teaching English.
Yeah.
So I think Comrade Jackson could tell us more about the unfortunate particulars of a person going to a culture center and saying, hey, I'll teach English to the kids. I love kids.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to make a bit of money off this.
Yeah.
So, again, you have the floor, sir. Please tell us about this.
All right, man. There's like two types of culture centers. One that like you went to, this community-based, and if you live in the area, you're eligible to go there as a student or a teacher. And you can go in there as long as you find your own students and you got them all together, you can charge whatever you want and just pay for the room rental. That's it, and that's a beautiful thing. All money goes in your pocket directly. And everything you teach is just direct to the students. And you have a relationship with no middleman there. That's great. No problem. But there's this company called Culture Center Group. It's the Culture Center Group. Like, they open up in Ito-Yokados, the shopping centers and things like that. And the corners, Eons. They have the corner. It's like culture groups. And what it is, it's just like a whole floor of a shopping center. And they divide it off into different classrooms. And all the time they got shit in there like belly dancing, French class, sword fighting, French like calligraphy, and all kinds of shit. Guitar. Yeah.
Trust me, I saw that list like it's madness. It's madness. Right? It's, the thing they offer is like crazy.
It's totally insane. And you go in there and when you try to teach, you try to, you know, think it's like where you live at type of culture center.
Yeah.
It's not like that at all. They take 60% of your money.
60% you say?
60 and give
that's
you
insane.
Money. You know what they say it's for? They say it's for advertising, lights, gas, water, just bills of four walls.
I'm sorry to take the mic from you for a second. I've been in these culture centers. What are you saying, like advertising, lights, gas? They don't advertise anything. What they do is put this list on a board, the community board, which is right outside the culture center, and list all the available classes. So this claim they're taking 60% for that?
No. That's the real one. The one you're talking about, that's the real culture center. That's where they, you know.
Talk more.
Yeah, they have it on the board, right? What all classes they
have. They're not talking about 6% for that.
No. Not that. What they do, it's still bullshit, but it's not what you're thinking. Like, the one that's bullshit, they have their own newsletter that they print out.
Oh, that kind of. Okay.
Yeah. And they claim that they put it in Asahi Shimbun, the Asahi.
But they don't!
The thing they do, they put it in the classified section. People that come and they, but you know, now's a digital age. Ain't nobody reading fucking paper newspapers anymore. If people are, I mean, thank you, do that. You know, that's awesome. But a lot of folks don't do that. They depend on their media through digital outlets. You know, so when they do shit like this, you know, they're just saying, oh, we're taking 60% of whatever the fuck you're doing to do that. So a dude like me, I'm trying to hustle every time, every chance I get. So I throw in an extra $10, 1,000 yen on top of my lesson fee, and I tell them it's for text and materials. You know, Japanese folks are not like American folks, because American folks, if we see buy one get one free, we're taking that shit. Japanese folks, if they see buy one get one free, they say, what's wrong with it? You know, if we hear something like we get a subscription for this and get a year-long shit for free, oh, we're jumping on that. Japanese folks here, we get a free, like, 1 year or something, they're like, what's wrong with it? We don't know what to do with it. Like, we'll take big money in America free, like, hey, that's our entitlement, that's whatever. You show that to a Japanese person, they're not gonna bite. But if you show something like $2 off your $500 bill, boom, you got them.
Discount. That's where it's at.
It's like one cent discount, boom, they got it.
Discount, you know, in Japan, it works every time.
Every time it does. Yeah. And so when folks hear that and they get that, but see, now think about the opposite side. If they get like 200 or like, let's say 1,000 yen, probably like $10, you know, plus onto their fee, they're going to be like, what the fuck? Why am I paying this? You know, just like you would if you look at your phone bill and they subscribe you to Yahoo News.
Fuck, that's not for Yahoo News. Hey, that's not for that shit.
You're like, I never use that. Take that shit off, you know.
Fuck you. You call somebody, right?
Yeah, they'll hit you up and they're like, what's this for? And when they tell the culture center that, like, what's this for? The culture center will throw you to the dogs every time. Oh, we don't know. You got to ask the teacher. And not even knowing that you're over there trying to survive and make your money, because these motherfuckers over here are taking 60% of your goddamn money and giving you 40%. So you put that $10 on it just to kind of make things even, but they're trying to make it unfair even more. Then they'll try to hit you up on the side and say, hey, this is kind of unreasonable. You don't have to charge all of that. And I'm like, well, bitch, don't charge me 60% of my money. And then so what you ultimately end up doing is stealing your students at the 60% place and just hosting them at a real culture center place or privately at a coffee shop.
Now that is some goddamn truth.
Yeah.
A lot of people think that coming to Japan, teaching English, it's some kind of fairy tale dreamland. You know, our friend, Comrade Jackson, I just told you what it's like to be on your own here in Japan.
Yeah.
And gave you just a little bit of insight of the dirty business of trying to make a living as a passionate, caring English teacher in this country. Which is another segue into our final point. And this is controversial. It's actually dangerous for him and me to even bring this up. It's talking about the fact that majority of these language education companies in this country have zero interest in actual education.
That's true.
Now, you may think that's not true, but friends, comrades, you know yourselves that the ultimate goal of any capitalist is profit. And you hear Comrade Jackson tell you how he fights this, how he tries his best to cut out the capitalist from fucking him as a working person, from getting the profit of the ultimate dead labor that they seek to benefit from, to retain it himself. So what we want to talk about finally here is just how dirty all of this is. Just how wrong it is to treat educators in this fashion. You know, to make us fight against each other at times. You ever worked at Eikawa?
Mm-mm.
You know what Eikawa's about, right?
Eikawa? Like the general sense, or is it like a show?
I would say, what's his stuff, man? Nova, you know.
Oh, yeah, like the company Eikawa, right?
Eikawa, yeah.
Yeah, the business is fucking dirty, man. It's like...
Tell me about Eikawa. Tell me about how they make workers fight against themselves.
Mm-hmm.
In order to, like, even bring money home for their own fucking kids.
Yo, they'll
cut... Tell about Eikawa, how they make workers fight against each other.
They'll cut it out in a heartbeat, man. They'll put you up against another person if, like, you're handsome, you're more handsome than the next person. I'm not even taking into consideration that person has a higher skill level than you, probably even college education, to, like, teach English better than you. But you're just handsome and you're more cool and things like that. They'll take you over the educated person just because, and it's not even a fair game there. It's not at all, you know. When folks come against each other and it comes down to renewing contracts or things like that, you gotta be cool, you gotta be hip, you gotta be in the eye of everybody to do that, and that's just not a safe place. It's not a secure place either, you know. So, if you're ever working in an Eikawa situation or something like that, get what you can get and then get the fuck out.
Don't stay at Eikawa. Don't trust Eikawas.
Yeah.
They're not good companies. They don't have, you know, you talk about like the dirtiest of the dirtiest.
Yeah.
Eikawas are the worst to work for as an English teacher in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
They make it very clear they don't give a damn about you.
Yeah.
Now, you think that's not true, get in with them. Sign your name on the dotted line, homeboy. You know, go through like a six month run with an Eikawa.
You're going to be handing out tissues.
Oh, I'm going to tell you how you'll be treated. Man, you are shit from the get-go. Again, that's we're trying to explain here.
Yeah.
The actual dirty.
Mm.
And what you actually deal with these like companies, right? And how wrong it is.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Jackson,
yeah, man.
As a final comment to finish this up,
mm.
You know, what would you say about the way passionate, caring English teacher are treated in Japan?
Oh, God, never mind. You got enough time?
Oh, please, sound off.
Like, you will have your dreams crushed so motherfucking quickly, it'll make your head spin. Like, you come out here thinking that you're going to be the best, you can be the best thing Japan has to offer, and you're going to fix their little English broken society, and all this other, you're going to get your feelings hurt in a heartbeat. You're just going to get slammed on right there. Like, you can't come in and then try to change something that's been going on, like, decades longer than you've been alive. When you come in here and you try to do that, now you're not part of the system. You're a kink in the system and you'll be flushed out. Like, so your dreams will get crushed quick if it's not by somebody telling you no. It's something like a financial burden that'll be put on your salary. and you get penalized, you're not going to be making money, you know. So then what they're going to do when you start doing the right things, they'll start paying you more. And so what does that cause? That causes favoritism, not like within a company or something, but within yourself. You know, you think, I know what I should be teaching, I know what I should be doing, but I'm getting paid to teach this way, I'm getting paid to teach this thing, so everything's going to be all right. Until contracts come and they let your ass go.
Word. I tell you something about that, man. You stand for yourself.
Yeah.
You stand for yourself in Japan by yourself, an English teacher, you're going to get fucked.
They got a saying that the nail that sticks out the furthest gets hammered first.
Oh, let me tell you about that, eh? Mm-hmm. You know, so only thing I can suggest, I think even Comrade Jackson, in his freelance expertise and the way he does things,
mm-hmm.
even he could agree that if you really want to protect your job and you really want to fight these capitalist bastards in the current situation that we are under as English teachers, your only real option is to organize
mm-hmm.
and to make a connection with your fellow teachers and unionize. That's all you really have.
Mm-hmm.
You can unionize or you can walk away.
Exactly.
The hope for revolution, well, you're full of shit.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, yeah, right? You know?
Yeah.
But what you can do to protect your family, protect your long-term interest, and hopefully, maybe like this goddamn fucking March, make things a little better for the next bastard that gets suckered into the position you're in right now, is organize and unionize. That's all you really got.
Yep.
And on that note, we're gonna get out of here. Thank you so much for watching this video, man. I hope you enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope you enjoyed hearing teachers talk real. Instead of this bullshit you hear all the time about people talking about how wonderful and great things are.
Mm-hmm.
Real worker, teacher, proletariat truth.
Hell yeah. You guys take it easy, man. You want to hear my album? Go to bandcamp.com/PAYTYT.
Check it out.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be worth your time. I've checked out myself.
Mm-hmm.
He got some good raps.
Yeah. If you want to see teaching ideas, teaching tips, teaching curriculums, things like that, just go to whiteshinobi.org. It'll all be there for you.
Also, good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
How she is. Until next time.